Hi, my name is Peter Lehman. I'm the director of the Center for Film, Media, and Popular Culture at Arizona State University. Can everyone hear okay?
Yes.
Do we have sound coming out okay? It's my pleasure to begin some brief introductions here today. And I think many of you know that this is a co-sponsored event, and in a minute you'll be hearing from the director of the Arizona Center for Medieval and Renaissance Studies, Bob York, who's the other co-sponsoring Arizona State University Center that's making this possible. So I just thought I would say a few words about how it was that Bob and I came to work on this together. He'll probably correct one or few details in my memory, but my memory, Bob, goes something like this. A little over a year ago, he suggested we have lunch together to talk about the possibility of seeing whether our centers might do something together. And one of the things that happens at a big research university is we go to lots of long meetings that last for hours at a time, and we sometimes think, gee, much of what goes on at those meetings doesn't seem particularly exciting or relevant to us. But I've gone to so many meetings for so many years, and one of the people that's always been at those meetings is Bob York, and I've always thought he's one of the most impressive people that attends those meetings and contributes to them. So I was really delighted when he suggested we get together to see whether we might do something. And I wasn't quite certain what we were going to be talking about, but when he said he'd like to see if we might find something to collaborate on, I searched my mind and thought, well, one of the few things that popped into my mind was Game of Thrones, because of the obvious intersection of common areas, which is, at that time and still now, it was one of the most wildly popular television shows in the country. Many of you probably know it got nominated for more Emmy Awards than any other show again this year, so it retains that incredible popularity with the public, with the critics, and is quite a phenomenal, successful show. And I think one of the things we can do for those of us that work in film and television and popular culture is connect with people based upon, it makes sense when you're doing that kind of outreach to want to use something that is connecting with a large audience, and Game of Thrones is doing that right now. I think when I mentioned that show to Bob, he hadn't seen one episode of it, but he's a good open-minded person, and he said, let me run that past some other people. And so that was the beginning of the idea. And then we saw an opportunity to apply for an Arizona Humanities Council grant. We want to thank the Arizona Humanities Council for giving us a grant to support this, which made it possible for us to invite distinguished speakers, whom you are about to hear today, that will be part of this. So instead of just drawing on resources here at Arizona State University, we have three distinguished guests that we will introduce shortly to you that will bring much, I think, as you'll see, to the discussion that we're going to have. After each of their presentations, we will get to involvement with all of you with questions and discussion about what they're talking about. So I'm going to turn this over to Bob, and I just want to say that it's been a great pleasure for me and for the Center for Film, Media, and Popular Culture to work with the Arizona Center for Medieval and Renaissance Studies. We're already working on other grants, and we hope to be able to be doing more things with movies and television that intersect our common areas of study. So, Bob.
Thank you, Peter. I just want to reiterate our thanks to the Arizona Humanities Council, which is now called Arizona Humanities. It's an extremely important entity in Arizona for the support of any kind of humanistic endeavor and study, and it deserves our support, if even by just attending the events that it supports. So I reiterate that thanks, and thanks to Peter for collaborating on this event. When he mentioned Game of Thrones, I had heard of it, but I hadn't seen a single episode. I saw the first episode and was so repulsed it was hard for me to look at the next. And then I binge watched all the way through season four. I neglected all of my duties at the university. I didn't read a single scholarly word. And I've been demoted since then to, no, I haven't been demoted. I'm convinced that this is a major cultural event in very many ways, and it's worth exploring it with distinguished faculty and thinkers who actually know something about the field and about filmmaking and about the importance of the intersection of the present with the past through a medium like film. So it's a delight to be here today, and I'm glad you're all here with us. Kelly DeVries is going to be our first speaker. I've known Kelly for years. We've worked on at least one project together. I'm the general editor of the Oxford Dictionary of the Middle Ages, and I had asked Kelly to write a huge number of articles for that publication, and we've gotten to be friends ever since. We see each other in Leeds especially, but and I know what a dynamic speaker is, and I was delighted when he said yes, he would be willing to join us. I would like him to introduce himself, however, because Peter and I would like this to be as informal as possible, despite the fact that we're speaking at a podium. It's mainly so you can hear us. But I'd like him to introduce himself and talk a little bit about his involvement in Game of Thrones, and then give us his presentation. Before I have him come up, though, I'd just like to say a word of thanks to our donors in the audience who support us in so many different ways and support the Center for Film, Media, and Popular Culture. And I encourage those of you who are not already donating, and the amount of donation is in some ways irrelevant. It's the number of people who donate that's most noticeable to upper level administration. But I encourage you to consider giving even a small amount of money to either center, but preferably to mine. In any case, philanthropy really matters, and Arizona Humanities is an example of that, and we all have to participate in that endeavor as well. So Kelly.
Thank you. This is somewhat of a homecoming to me. I was born and raised in Utah, and during my high school years debated, I think we had every debate every week in Tempe or down in Tucson, so I came through quite a lot. I haven't been back since, surprisingly, and it has changed, and it hasn't changed some too, so I'm very pleased to get back. I'm currently a professor of history at Loyola University in Baltimore, Maryland. I am also the historical consultant for the Royal Armouries in the United Kingdom, and as such, get to play with some arms and armor, as you'll get a chance to see in just a little bit. I've written quite a large number of books. I have a couple of them coming out fairly soon, one on wounds and wound repair during the Middle Ages, some of which I will be drawing on today, and also one on flaying. Actually, I only have an article in that one, but on flaying, which is appropriate to Game of Thrones, where it seems flaying takes place more regularly than probably should, to say the least. I've been involved with TV and documentaries and other productions on various history shows. Back when the History Channel actually showed history, I was on quite a bit. There was a week called Barbarians Week, and I was on every night, and every night that week, and every hour on Sunday but two, because I had been in all these barbarian things as the everything that had to do with Vikings or the Dark Ages or weapons and so forth. I was on. Now, of course, I'd have to own a pawn shop or be a duck hunting bigot or something to get a TV show on the History Channel. So I haven't done as much there. I have got an HBO show coming out sometime soon called Game of Thrones Historical Connections, which is rather funny. And I say funny not because it's a wonderful opportunity. It's a wonderful opportunity to work with HBO. And it also was interesting that by accident they let us slip who's going to win. And when I realized that, and they realized that, they swore me to secrecy. So it's kind of fun. I don't, knowing the spoilers to a certain extent. It also is a little bit odd that when I got involved in this, I got involved before the first Game of Thrones was coming out. I had looked at the books and skimmed a few of them. I wasn't, any time a 700-page book is put in front of me, it's got to be a chore. It's got to be something that I really want to look through, so I've been reluctant. And Foreign Affairs, the intellectual political science and diplomatics journal, in out of New York City, the editor called me and said, I'd like you to do an article on how medieval Games of Thrones is. Well, I thought it was a joke. I thought, well, okay, I guess you can do that, but I mean, why would anybody want to think, compare the real Middle Ages with Game of Thrones? So I took it as a kind of a tongue-in-cheek exercise. And I said, Game of Thrones wasn't very medieval. And I was glad about that, because the Middle Ages was actually kind of boring, what with this umbrella church and all these peasants running around and everything. And evidently that was precisely what they wanted, is for me to tell them that that we're not going to see a whole bunch of peasants running around in an umbrella-like church, and somehow the boring stuff was going to be taken out, and in between would be a lot of violence, which, if you've seen the show, as all of you have, is the case. I pointed out in this recent show, they talking to peasants, I said, notice how many times they're riding through the countryside and there's no fields being tilled? I mean, what the hell do they eat? I guess they're all on a fish diet, anyway, now in discussing violence in relationship to Game of Thrones, medieval violence, real accurate historical violence versus Game of Thrones or other TV shows, movies, I'm sure if you're like me, you watched The Bastard Executioner, Carl Sutter's Sons of Anarchy set in the Edwardian, Edward the First time in England this past week. It wasn't particularly good, which actually means I will watch it more. I have a collection of really bad Viking movies, and some of you will be stumped on that now to try to think of a really good Viking movie, and you can't. So you can just stop now, other than How to Train Your Dragon. We don't count that one. But there are hundreds of really bad ones, and I collect them gleefully and watch them and see the violence. But this brings me to a kind of a story of when I was being the historical consultant. That's why I've got this show up. This was Deadly Warriors. I was Spike TV a few years back. I was a historical consultant for a couple of their shows. One of them in particular was this one, Pirate versus Knight. And no, under no conditions ever would the pirate win, but did. So that'll tell you where they went away from history. But they called me up and said, well, we'd like a decapitation. And I said, why? Well, they decapitation on TV. And I said, well, you know how hard it is to have a decapitation in battle. They said, no. So I was trying to describe about the male warriors wearing mail and a steel gorget, that in fact there'd be something protecting the neck, a metal piece coming up from the arm and protecting the neck, and male that would be coming from the coif and also around the neck. So we really have three layers of armor that they would have to get through before they even hit whatever was being worn underneath, leather, padded felt, or so forth. Then cut through the skin, muscle, bone, and back out the same way. And they said, well, are you saying that that wouldn't have happened on a battlefield? I said, it never did. So far, we've excavated hundreds and hundreds of bodies. We've never found anybody who was missing a head on the battlefield. We've got massacre victims. We'll talk about them in just a moment, but no decapitation like that. So the obvious question followed. He said, well, how would a knight have killed another one? And I said, well, they all wore long daggers. Every time you look at the knights in effigy or you look at suits of armor, they have their swords on the right, and on the left is a long dagger, needle-like dagger, sometimes with two little curly things at the end that they call them the ballock daggers for obviously reasons. But what they would do is as soon as the knight was demobilized, which happened fairly frequently, because he is carrying a lot of armor and these things can cause concussions and so forth, then the warrior would take the dagger out and he would lift the mail up and stick it into the neck, into the carotid artery, or lift the mail up underneath the armpit, stick it into the heart, or lift the mail in the crotch and stick it into the femoral artery. And I heard nothing on the TV, and they said, we can't show that on TV. So decapitation, evidently, but not the real idea with you know, a guy with a little pricker down there and boop. Now, and they have shown decapitation on TV, not necessarily on that show, but there we go. Of course, the most famous first decapitation of many on the Game of Thrones, Ned Stark, is executing the Black Watch soldier who's come down to tell him that there are these ice zombies that are never going to get to the wall. But he should be worried about that. There still aren't to the wall, are they? Anyway, he gets his head cut off for being impertinent and leaving his post, only to find that Ned will have his cut off in a short time afterwards. I always like that. You know, a character is awesome when people still talk about him several series after his death. That's fine. It's also something that if you are an aficionado of these type of films, you do realize, of course, that Sean Bean gets killed in every one. And I now actually come to grips with the fact that he gets killed in all the ones that are good, which is the only reason that explained Jupiter Ascending being so absolutely bad is that they did not kill Sean Bean. If they had, it would have worked like nobody did. Just this week, there was a decapitation in the first episode of The Bastard Execution. And here's one of the scenes where he's getting ready, and here we're about to see the brother of the bad guy get his head lopped off by the good guy. All of this being relative. And there were executions that went on during the Middle Ages. This is a very famous scene. This is in the Royal Armories. You can find it in the Tower of London. It's actually a cheat, because not because it isn't real, but because it isn't medieval. Actually, the axe dates from about the 18th century, and the block from the 17th century. It was used to execute the last person who was executed by decapitation in England. More accurate was the executioner's sword. It was very rare that an axe was used in execution during the Middle Ages. It was much more a sword. And often with the individual kneeling, as you can see here, this is from the Lutrell Psalter, and presumably he's getting executed, who knows? Could have been any other reason, but executions did happen, and the execution by decapitation happened quite often. So the accuracy of that is perhaps easiest to look at it in a medieval vein. Just recently, in 2009, a mass grave was discovered on Ridgeway Hill in Dorset that contained the bodies of 50 Vikings, all missing their heads, or the heads were apart from their bodies. All were male and all had been killed by decapitation. and it looks very likely that they were killed by swords from the blows. Their heads were placed in the southern part of the grave. Apart from the obvious trauma, 76% of the skulls bore a sharp force trauma. The rest appeared on the neck. There had also been, very similar to this, marks of trying to hold off the blows with forearms and hands, and injuries to the fingers as well. Initially when this was found, the English, who have kind of a certain nationalism about them, those of us who study English England, or those of us who've lived in England a lot time, we understand. So the English immediately jumped to, this is Boadicea's massacre of Romans. No evidence whatsoever, just Boadicea's. And of course, somebody pointed out that they were much too young to be Boadicea's. So then the next thing was, they were Vikings. And they were Vikings that were being killed by Anglo-Saxons. He said, well, okay, they do turn out to be Vikings, but I think this is very similar, it's strangely similar to the scene in Jom's Viking saga, where the Vikings who are now settled in this part, or would have been settled in this part, take on the Vikings who are coming in raiding. And in any case, we do have these 50 Viking bodies, and the English have now determined were executed between 982 and 1016, and obviously by good old Anglo-Saxons and not by Vikings. But it did happen. Other means of execution could be more ruthless and a lot more painful. William Wallace was hanged, castrated, although I had one student, this is a new monument that's been put up since the film Braveheart, in Smithfield in London, that goes through everything. And it does include the castration, even though Mel Gibson strictly had it removed from the scene in the battle, in the movie. I guess that's probably the right thing to do, because my students keep calling it circumcision. So evidently, William Wallace was hanged and then circumcised, beheaded and then quartered. So he clearly had it, had something more ruthless and longer. And then there is the existence of Friar. And that one, in my estimation, would maybe have been the most painful means of death, and also was most frequently used, primarily because the church used it as their form of capital punishment. They couldn't do it. The state always had to carry those out, but it was through burning that they accomplished it. And this is, by the way, where Joan of Arc was burned. That's why I put that up there. Sometimes it's very interesting, there's combined burning. You got to understand that all capital punishment was really for treason. And you couldn't be killed just on murder. Treason. So if you did, in fact, kill somebody in the royal family, that was treason against the king. If you were adulterous against the king, which is what happens to Henry and his eight two wives, then you could be killed because that would be treason to the king. If you were treasonous to the church, you could be burned. And that's one of the reasons why burning is used. Well, two of the lower level Wars, Roses, Rebels are being burned, and they've kind of had a dual execution. So they've had their intestines drawn out of them, what is called drawing, and those are lit on fire first. And then the fire pyres lit on fire. And so they have this rather interesting conversation, I'm sure not recorded exactly correctly, but about the whole meaning of life and what it was, you know, did they expect to get executed eventually for what they would do. I found that in grad school. I've never found it again, and I'm really dying to have this philosophical discussion or to read this philosophical discussion again. As I said, that emphasized that the executions were only for treason in the Middle Ages. During the early modern period, then, other crimes began to be placed have the punishment of execution, desertion and other things like that were frequent. The treason against the church also started up, and there were far more executions, far more bloody torture weapons and other things like that. I'm always all intrigued whenever I see something on torture in the Middle Ages, and out they cart all these counter-reformation torture devices, because people from the same religion, they hate each other a lot more than people from different religions, because one declaring the other as heretic is far worse. And so out comes the rack, and out comes the thumb screws and everything else that aren't around during the Middle Ages. Nobility mattered in executions. Gilles de Rais, who was the most prolific pedophilic murderer in the history of the world, killed well over 150 children, it is thought, and was able to get away with it because he was a member of the royal family. He'd also even fought with Joan of Arc for a while. But he was both a pedophilic murderer and a devil worshiper, and it's the devil worshiper that gets him to be executed. But because he is a noble of the house, of the royal house, he is strangled before his fire is set. And his two accomplices, who were both younger males who had accepted to help him rather than meet the fate of all these that he had killed, they were actually burned. The magician who he had hired, a man by the name of Francois Perletti, was let go. Almost everybody were afraid of what he might do, even though he hadn't done any of the thing and was just a big con artist. It later is revealed that Perletti does die, is killed by somebody else who's trying to con. So, non-noble people, unlike Gilles de Rais, went to the fire. But the fact of the matter is the capital punishment in this way and violence in this way was very few. Now, I say that about the central of Europe. I say it about the center of Islam as well. On the frontiers, we have different roles playing out, our different worlds playing out. We have different means of execution. We have different reasons for execution. We also have a lot less value of human life. In the background, this is a contemporary illustration from the Siege of Rhodes, 1480. In the background, you can see what looks like a whole bunch of people standing with sticks up their bums. They actually have sticks up their bums. This is impaling. And the Ottomans are using it in order to scare the Rhodians into surrendering. It doesn't happen. But that's part of it. This is where we get the famous legend of Vlad the Impaler, Dracula, son of Dracul, who impaled his victims. Very interesting. I think it was the second book in my I reviewed in my career. Had all the original sources of impaling, and you had and the letter from Pope Pius II saying, "Way to go! You're killing Ottomans. Go ahead." But the Germans were appalled at impaling. Actually, that's a good phrase, appalled and impaled. While the Russian sources were kind of like, you got to impale every once in a while. So it was really kind of on the frontiers that you didn't know. On frontiers also with flaying, this volume is going to be continued, or brought up. There's very, very few actual cases of impaling. Even though one of the most famous saints, and one of the saints that is depicted everywhere, is Saint Bartholomew, who is impaled in the ancient world. So impaling comes up all the time, but there's very few times that it has actually happened. I wrote on one where it did, although it didn't take place until 1571, a man by the name of Marc Antonio Bragadin, who was the defender of Famagusta against the Ottomans in 1570-71, and he held out. They went for conditional peace, and there's something at the peace table. No one particularly knows what happened, either the Ottoman or the Venetian side. Something happened, and Mustafa, the general on the side of the Ottomans, went nuts, and he ordered that everybody be killed, and he ordered that Bragadin be flayed. And then it's very clear that nobody knows how to do it. They have to go get a couple of butchers to come do it. And they will do it. They will flay him. Although most of the others are let go, and one of the reasons we have several eyewitnesses to it. This is his tomb in San Paolo San Pedro e Paolo in Venice. And in fact, it was opened in 1960s 1996, and his skin was found behind it. It had been brought back from Istanbul, which is kind of creepy in its own right. The frontiers were always being threatened. Goths, Visigoths and Ostrogoths, Vandals, Huns, Burgundians, Franks, Lombards, Avars, Carolingians, Hungarians, Normans, Vikings, Saracens, Russians, Seljuks, Crusaders, Mongols, Ottomans. They're always preying on all of the frontiers during the Middle Ages. But it must be remembered that unless you are there and constantly under attack and don't move, which some do, but often anybody who's been attacked a couple of times tries to find another field to till. Often those are not violence that would be against the common person, because the common person provided the food. They did not provide a threat. And eventually, most peoples, the Mongols are perhaps the exception here, but the most peoples recognize that if they're going to conquer those lands rather than invading them, they have got to actually bring the people into compliance. So you can't do too much to the peasant class or the urban class, because you need them to be your workers or your taxes. So you only do it to the nobles or to the soldiers. The biggest forms of violence, just to be very quick on it, against peasants would be natural. Famine, flood, disease. Black Death was quite a violent catastrophe. So we look sort of to warfare as the most obvious evidence of violence. Beheadings I've talked about. There are none that we've come through. All the excavations of the hundreds. I forgot that. That's Bartholomew's head being flayed. This is Michelangelo's, and it's rumored that that's Julius II's head on there. He was the Pope who made Michelangelo do the Sistine Chapel. We don't know for sure. All the bodies have been excavated. There have been hundreds of bodies excavated that have died by violent means. And there are, by my account, no beheadings other than the massacre ones. There's, by my account, only 3 amputations. So last week when we saw the bastard executioner and we had the obligatory lop off of the arm so that the blood gets spurt out. I think that's been going on since The Evil Dead. Probably earlier than that. There are only 3 amputations that take place that have been excavated that are clearly amputated. The limb is amputated during the battle. And those 3 all, interestingly, were at Aljubarrota, a battle fought in the late 14th century in Spain. At Visby, where these rather gruesome examples come from, and at all other sites, the wounds are to the limbs, none of those are fatal, or to the head, and those are generally fatal. There's very few, if any, to the torso. Here's a perfect example. The Visby battle was fought on sacred grounds. It was fought on Solberga nunnery, and so they simply buried the dead in the ground. The Danes took theirs back. But the Swedes, the Gotlanders, were just simply put theirs in the ground there. And 3 of the 5 grave mounds have been excavated. And, of course, they found a number of these things. It was a Sunday. They did not take the armor off. Here, for example, is one that still has his mail buff on him, but doesn't show. He shows a cheek wound. That may have been the fatal one there. This one we have no idea. It's just a cool picture. The male sitting there. Here's another one with all of these. The Swedes love this. They've got them all in there. They've got all the bones stacked up in the storerooms, but they put all the skulls with the coops of males still on them on display. This one, we can tell what killed him. You can tell what killed him, and it was right across the face. So, that is the type of wounds we see that will do people in. What is more my experience, though, is that there were hardier folk. that these people really, who went out and fought, did so, were wounded, and actually then had the wounds start to heal and come back. So let me give you a few examples. 30 skulls dating from the 6th and 8th century were found in medieval cemeteries in southern Germany. They exhibit cranial fractures. But 23 of these skulls showed healing of earlier weapons, of earlier cuts and earlier weapons. In Lipinski, in Serbia, there was an axe blow to one of the males who was excavated, and it had started to heal. He was killed by a blow to the head later on. But so the axe blow had been at an earlier battle. One Algebrata soldier was fighting on the healed stump of a leg that, because of the roughness of the cut, was likely received in an earlier battle, and yet he went out there. He probably was called Stumpy. But believe it or not, we found that term associated with some soldiers, probably called Stumpy, and he didn't make it through the next battle. Probably the most harrowing one is an Avar soldier that was found in a dig where his entire side of his head was caved in by a blunt force trauma, so either by an axe or a mace or a club. It would have gone into his brain, there's no doubt, but there was healing on the wound, showing that he lived for at least 6 months afterwards. He may have been demoted to the village idiot, but he had lived for 6 months afterwards. So these were very hardy folk. And one of the most interesting things, and part of this is because the armor is so good, is one of the things I tried to express in Spike TV. I won't go into it now because I'm sure I'm well out of my time, but just to show you the mail and how good it, I mean, this was around for 1,000 years. Very, very hard to penetrate it. This is a coat of mail I found in Sweden that actually dates from the Viking period, so we can tell that it's been around for a long time. And then by the middle of the 15th century, this is early 15th century, plate armor begins to replace it. Almost impossible to get through. There is the full plate on both sides. And I was put in, and even brigandines, which were the cloth-covered armor that was placed around the body. And if you look at any Renaissance painting of the noble families, the Estes family in Ferrara, for example, the Sforzas in Milan, and the Medicis in Florence, you could see that they're all wearing cloaks with rivets everywhere. They're not. They're wearing brigandines. They're wearing armor under their clothes. And if you know the Medici story about Giuliano being assassinated in the church and Lorenzo being attacked by knife, you know it was wise to wear armor at that point. But all of the armor was much protected, which is why we don't have wounds to the torso. I learned this firsthand because I was walking around the Wallace collection in London once with the head of conservation for the Royal Armouries. And this is what he told me as I was, or what he asked me as I was asking him questions about the armor flexibility. He said, "It appears to me you've never worn armor." Like I was the only one. And so now we're going to educate DeVries here. And so the next week they did put me in, and I'm kind of embarrassed to say it was Henry VIII's fattest suit. And it's still, you know, breathe in, breathe in. They couldn't get the calf cannons on because I'd ridden a bicycle. And in fact, what you recognize is that medieval people didn't even run, because their calves are all very thin. And so here's me putting some of it on. There it is at the end. And yes, now I have joined the numbers that have worn armor. Finally, I want to kind of end up with having done some work on Richard III's recent remains. Here he is with skin. Here he is without. In the car park, this was a few years back that he was discovered, as the remains were discovered in a car park. They were made certain that it was his through DNA testing and comparison. Here's his skull just peeking out of the dirt. And there's the whole of the body. Evidently didn't have legs. No, that's the legs were gone. There's the skull. Now, the skull does show some damage. You can see right in the front in the nasal cavity there's damage. That actually came in from behind, and that's the thing that cracks the teeth down below. There we go. I'm going to have to come back to that. So there's, you can see the part of his skull that was taken off of the blow. his first two wounds right underneath his cheek, because they were cutting off his helmet. He would have been very too well protected, so the first two wounds were cutting off his helmet. The next one, he's standing straight up here, and they suspect that he was on kneeling, and he gets a dagger, all those damn daggers again, he gets a dagger through the top of the skull. If that didn't kill him, he then falls forward, and he may also have had daggers at the front. There's some dispute about that. But when he falls forward, he gets a sword, simultaneous with another, with a halberd point going through the back, and then also what appears to be a bill that cut across the back. Any of those would have been fatal. As he's dragged from the one burial spot to the other, we see that he gets stabbed in the ass. There it is. And that was a paramortem wound, and I could guarantee that the soldier who made it never had to buy another pint in another pub for his life, because he could always say, guess who stabbed the king in the ass? I do want to finish, if I've got just a second more, with one of the more interesting passages that kind of brings this all to an end, talks really about the violence of what was life, but not life for everybody, perhaps not as many to as many people in the Middle Ages by per capita as there is in Westeros or in England during Bastard Executioner's Day. One of the ones that's most striking to me, Dante, the great poet, followed a wounded individual from during the Battle of Campaldino, where Dante fought. This man, who was named Buonconte Montefeltro, had been shot through the neck, or stabbed through the neck. We're not exactly sure. But somebody had gotten it underneath his armor and stabbed it through the neck. It was Dante's responsibility, it seems, for him to follow this man. He says, he runs into him in Paradiso, in Purgatorio, sorry, and this is the Canto 5. Another spoke, so may the Lord Divine fulfill the wish that draws you up the mountain for sweet compassion. Lend your ear to mine. I am Buonconte, once of Montefeltro. Because Giovanna and the rest forget me, I go among these souls with head bowed low. And I, what force or chance led you to stray so far from Campaldino, that your grave remains undiscovered to this day. There flows below the Casentino a stream, the Arcana, which rises above the hermitage in Apennino. There, where its name ends, is Larno's flood. I came, my throat pierced through, fleeing on foot and staining all my course with my life's blood. There my sight failed. There with a final moan, which was the name of Mary, speech went from me. I fell, and there my body lay alone. Dante had followed him. I followed Dante's trail from the battlefield to where this man fell. It took him a kilometer to bleed out from a blow in his neck. And that was the reality of medieval violence. Exsanguination. Exsanguination can take a very long time for a man to die. And in these sort of situations, it was frightening, traumatic. Dante never wrote about chivalry. He never wrote about war being good. Thank you.
Up for discussion now, if you like.
Do you want to start with getting response from the other panelists?
Yeah. Would the other panelists please come up and join us?
I do have a course card.
I guess the first one.
I talked to the mic so that people can. We've got the live mics here. So I think it's on.
No.
First thing that comes to mind is, do you have a sense of whether people in the Middle Ages, early Renaissance, had a particular fascination with images of wounds, or, you know, because I mean, obviously the images of Christ,
yes,
and Christ's yes. torture and death, as well as Saint Sebastian and the visibility of such grotesque wounds. In painting after painting after painting after painting.
Yeah, that's a very good question. It's kind of an interesting one that in introducing this book on wounds and wound repair, we had several with theology, a theological wound, or wanted to discuss theological wounds in the section we put in called stigmata. Very interesting to see a society that whose deity is marked by wounds and then arises above them, but carries those marks of the wounds even though he's deity as an example of what he has done for them. And that others who might carry those wounds, St. Francis being a perfect example, would then similarly be spiritual. And I wonder if that doesn't make it more comparatively banal to what might have been occurring in everyday life. And the same thing with St. Bartholomew. When I was working on the Lane article, I kept coming up with St. Bartholomew this, St. Bartholomew this. And they've got some really funny pictures of him. I put one of the most meek ones up there, but often he's carrying half his plain skin around, like he's, you know, just in the middle of something and it came off. But what you don't see then is that they still are able to separate that from everyday society. So it's, you know, geez, say Bartholomew has been flayed, shouldn't we be using flay? No, you never see Christians flay in the center, in the civilized and along the frontiers, not even there. Or Muslims. So Muslims don't have the same Bartholomew, but my point is that they don't then take that and say, oh, well, wounds are okay. I don't know what to make of that. And there's very effective means of bandaging. I meant to start out with the wound man, I should have, where all these wounds are put on these 15th century wound men to help the doctors identify what kind of wounds they might come across. The surgeons were very good. The military surgeons especially were very good. And that's why so many people are healing for later
battles.
Well, I was wondering that what is interesting to me is that so many characters in Game of Thrones have participated in battles, and that it is an interesting feature to me that men bond around that experience, that, you know, there's very little in terms of real emotion in the film that you can trust, but that camaraderie, that sharing, and that while there are a few people who have visible physical wounds, there seems to be a recurring sort of allusion to psychological wounds, that there's sort of PTSD kind of, you know, when you see the weapons or somebody is jousting, then you suddenly you hear the din of the battle and you're completely out of it, like a flashback or so. Is there information about such psychological wounds?
Not directly. I mean, they wouldn't have known how to see trauma as a psychological wound, but it's very, very much evidenced in all of the writings about war by participants. So, in fact, I've always said the last book I write, because it'll be the hardest one to write, is on trauma and how it's been there for forever. And I mean, I would open with Achilles' boots on the beach. Because if you read the Iliad, Achilles is traumatized. I mean, that's all it is. He's battle traumatized. He wouldn't have worried if a woman had been taken from him. He was used to this type of hierarchical divvying of spoils. But he is traumatized.
and a trauma that brings him back into the fold when his best friend and cousin is killed. You can see that in some of them. Jean de Joinville's accounts of his crusades with Louis the VII, very evident that Joinville, who was one of the soldiers along the lines, he is traumatized by what he sees, and he can't write exactly. He could write about what he sees in a way, but there's times he just can't. And in Rhodes, I finished a book of Rhodes, and there are eyewitnesses there all the time. And there's one, for example, in 1522, where the soldier, who is bastard son of the Prince Bishop of Liège, and a member of the royal family of France, but never claimed it because of his bastardy. But he writes elegant French, and he says, one day, he says, yes, I was wounded in the thigh. But I really can't complain, because this was the day our engineer was looking out of the wall, and a ball from a handheld gun went through and took out his eye and the side of his face. That man was back 6 weeks later doing the engineering again. So, you know, it is, you can get it, and I feel like I will sometimes get it. I mean, you can almost get it from, certainly from literary sources, you know, go right through Mort d'Arthur and find it, right through Beowulf, to be a perfect example. Beowulf has the shell-shocked warrior. I mean, he really is. Why stand there and say, oh, I'm going to take Red along with it, you know, I'll twist his arm off. Well, that's trauma. You know, he doesn't need to do that. He wouldn't do it unless he's trying to seek something. So I think that there's a lot of that can be found. And that's where literature, maybe not as well in TV and movies, can step into a historical scenario like the Middle Ages and give a better account of what is happening to the soldiers and to those who are participating in military things to fill in gaps that they would not have known how to diagnose at the time. I think Dante, when writing this passage, I've read it over and over and over again, Dante is traumatized by what he sees. He's followed this man for a kilometer, he sees the blood all along the trail, and then he sees the body disappear into the rivers and recognizes what has happened. From then on, he will not talk about war as a good thing or honorable thing.
I mean, there is sort of a jokey reference almost to it in some scenes in Game of Thrones, like when Cereal Pharrell is training with Arya Stark, and he says, you know, you have to pierce the body. You know, all men are made of water, and if you stick them, then the water runs out and they die. You know, that there's sort of a reference to bleeding out.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons I think that the medieval period gets used so often in fantasy and TV, is that we are dealing with not quick deaths. It's the exsanguination. There's a lot of blood. Whereas as soon as you get gunpowder weapons, you're going to have less blood, but also much more killing and much more democratized killing. The one thing that a person can do in the Middle Ages is if he sees somebody who is more wealthy than he is and recognizes that he preserves that body as a living person, he will make money. And that will stop his warping and march him off the side of the battle. As long as he doesn't have a Henry V who says, don't go kill the prisoners, he's going to, you know, he's going to become wealthier afterwards by selling this guy's freedom back. Well, a bullet being shot, a ball being shot, is going to have that same judgment. And so there's lots that will change as soon as gunpowder enters the scene. And consequently, you can't have the exsanguination, but you can't have rich people getting off, you can't have the heraldry. It doesn't matter anymore. So there's a lot of things that I think change at that point, which is probably also why the Middle Ages is so appealing to Game of Thrones, Bastard Executioner, all the crazy Viking films, and probably hundreds more.
Thanks.
Okay, I think this is supposed to be working. I don't know, can you folks hear? Have you been able to hear okay out there? I think we should probably go to, want to thank our other panelists here for these good questions and observations, but I'm hoping, Bob and I are both hoping here that at this point, you have some questions and observations you'd like to ask. You can direct them towards any of the panelists, but I think we might start with Kelly. Anyone have anything they'd like to contribute? We can get a mic. Is there someone who's walking around with a mic? If not, maybe we can.
I can walk around with a
We can get. We have some interns out here.
Oh, we do.
We have an intern out there who can. Oh, she runs one. Because I think.
I had a question about what you thought about Ramsay Snow's character. He's kind of like, I don't know if you got that far. But
oh, yeah, no, I've gotten that far. I don't like his character, but that's, I would be wrong if I said it and said, oh, wow, what a great guy.
Whose character did that become?
Ramsay Snow.
His penchant for flame is unsettling, shall we say. I think that there are obviously psychopaths that live at any time, and the psychopaths that are out there in the Middle Ages have to have protection, like he does, of course. From a nobility to exist, or from the ecclesiastical to exist, and we do have, I mean, Gilles de Rais, who I mentioned, his crimes were known, and he was suspected of them for several years, and with the result being 150 children, male and female, being killed by him. And when they finally get him to talk at the trial, and I really wish I hadn't read the trial transcripts because I can't get the images out of my head. But he was truly a psychopathic serial killer. And so you have to, and I've wondered, of course, you know, I always get asked, on this HBO show I was asked again, you know, where's George Martin drawing from? And I keep thinking, you know, he's alive, you can ask him. I kind of sometimes wonder if Ramsay Snow is not somewhat drawn from Gilles de Rais, not for what he does, but for the manner and ease that he thinks he can do it because of his role in relationship to nobility. So, it's an effective character. Somebody should have put a dagger in him by now, and hopefully we'll soon. Well, yes, I do know. Yes, I do know. Somebody should put a dagger in him. So.
If I can add to that, what you're speaking of.
Yeah, it's on.
What you're speaking of seems to plug into this one of the series' main concerns, which is what power does, and what happens if you get it. Because Ramsay is not unlike Joffrey, who is the man you love to hate. He's this hysterical, power-drunk guy who does everything wrong. Even his family knows he's wrong. At the other end of the spectrum is someone like Stannis, who is like a medieval monk. He's very ascetic. He wants the power, thinks he deserves it, but with a spiritual kind of justification, whereas people like Ramsay or Joffrey are, I'm royal blood, I'm the king, I do whatever I want. And so we have those two poles of what happens when you get too much power.
Well, Stannis does kill his daughter for ritualistic means. I was sitting at a table at a meeting of the descendants of Charlemagne, which is kind of a funny group anyway, and they invited me in, and this was an old lady, old Washington money thing. I've been watching Game of Thrones. Now, if she wasn't under 100,
I would have, I said, oh, she says, can you explain something to me? And I said, maybe. She says, is there anybody good? I don't know, Tyrion, maybe? If we kind of erase some of his moral problems.
I think someone's got the mic out there.
I just wanted to quickly maybe come back to that. I think, again, it's interesting that the violence that he exerts, you know, that psychological violence is such a big part of it, and that it's not enough to destroy the body or kill this person, but to kill the spirit, you know, to kill the essence of the person. And I think that exceeds sort of what we maybe read in medieval accounts that are very focused on the destruction of the body. You know, like when you look at the sagas, like, and then this part was hacked off, and then there it was pierced, and then here was a cut, you know, but the breaking this person until there's nothing left of them, I think that makes it so difficult to watch, and that's what fascinates audiences about this one.
Okay, well, first I wanted to thank the presenter.
Put the mic by your mouth, please.
First I wanted to thank the presenter, but one of the things that I noticed was that it primarily focused on violence performed by men against other men.
Right.
So one of the questions that I had for either the presenter or the rest of the panel was if there were differences either in fictional representations of the Middle Ages or in actual historical fact, if there were differences in either representations or ideas about violence against women.
Against women, not perpetrated by women.
Or perpetrated by women.
Yeah, there aren't a lot. And it's one of the interesting things about Joan of Arc. I wrote a book on Joan of Arc a long time ago, and she still thrills me as one of the most interesting and anomalic characters ever in history. There were these persistent claims that she never, ever actually killed anyone or even used her sword in violence. She, however, said differently that she had, in fact, swung a sword and so forth. She doesn't say to what effect. There are very few accounts where you all have women perpetrating the violence. There's a woman I found in a little tiny chronicle in the Eastern Mediterranean about a woman who uses archery. Clearly she's a huntress of some sort, but she uses archery to keep a group of raiders off of the island in the Eastern Mediterranean for her people. But they are so numerous, or they so infrequent, that they become highlighted just simply because of their infrequency. Violence against women is a very interesting one because a long time ago, I wrote an essay called Warfare and the Value of Human Life, because I was interested in the fact that the central core of Christianity and the central core of Islam both believed in the body as being uncorrupted. And consequently, they carried things out. They did things economically that the Romans would not have done, like surrounded cities with walls that were very expensive, put all the troops in armor that was very expensive. Both them had heavy prescriptions against rape. And you don't see in conquests, even in the Crusades, even in the Ottoman period, when the Ottomans conquered Constantinople, one of the modern historians, Stephen Runciman, had this, you know, rapine happening for 3 days. And I went through all the accounts, none. And it would have damaged an Ottoman soldier who raped a woman would have been condemned to hell. And so that would have been it. You can't get back from that. The woman would have as well, in this weird way that Islam sees these things, but the soldier would have. So it just was very rare. And I think that, now that's different on the side. Vikings had very different notions about when Mongols, surprisingly, were closer to the Ottomans and the Christians about the roles in play. In the Middle Ages, there's not as much violence towards women as there is in the ancient world or in the early modern world, by any stretch, in my estimation. Now, every time I say that, somebody's got a case or two to bring up. It does happen, but not in the numbers that we see carried forth in early modern warfare, or especially in modern warfare.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we have time for one more question. That is this woman over here, and we will have to move on to another wonderful speaker after one wonderful speaker whom we've already heard. So the last question for Kelly DeVries.
Hi, I had the question about this character. She doesn't exist in the books. They created her for the television show that is Rob Stark's wife.
Yes.
Taliesin, and he meets her because she's this enlightened woman healer on the battlefield. And I was curious, how would a woman, if there was such a thing, gain such healing knowledge and the idea that she would be permitted to operate independently on a battlefield seems as far-fetched as many things on Game of Thrones. But you spoke of wound healing and surgeons. Was there such a thing as women healers then?
Not on the battlefield. As far as I can tell, and I've reviewed every single surgeon we know by name or reputation, is there is a legend of one that is that comes out of the school of Salerno, which is a kind of school that's influenced both by Islamic surgical practices, Byzantine surgical practices, and even Northern European surgical practices during the height 7th to the 10th century is pretty much it. Still around 11th century, but starts dying off. And there is a legend that there is one woman there that trains surgical practice for use on battlefield. There is no others, and every named person we have are male. In there are women healers in towns, women surgeons primarily, not necessarily physicians, don't go with it. Anyway, but surgeons who are women. There are even some records of them coming through Montpellier's School of Medicine after the 13th century. They generally practice among women only. There were prohibitions for working with men, which is why we don't see them on the battlefield. But I did notice also that in Bastard Executioner this week, they introduced this healer witch and all sorts of things. And in Game of Thrones, they can do it fictionally because you don't have a religious misogyny that existed in the real Middle Ages. Religious misogyny is in Bastard Executioner, so they make Katie Sagal character a woman healer, witch, traitor, all sorts of things. We have yet to see what her husband is going to have her do on screen. It's pretty amazing, the first scene. But I'm not so... That is only fictional. And Martin is on record, George Martin is on record, saying that was not his choice to put her in the movie because it wasn't something he wanted, and it wasn't something, a role that he saw women play. He doesn't particularly like women, and she was likable as well. So there's a number of different things there. But the notion of having one on, especially to create this image that her unborn baby is going to be killed as well, which exactly happens in the Bastard Executioner, too, I think that's the reason, and less more that they're healing individuals and so forth. Medicine women, I guess, are druidesses, are much more literary than they are.
Maybe.
No, I'm sorry, that was an end. That was very...
coming up too close to lunch to have another speaker before we go to lunch, so we do have time for maybe one final question if someone has one. Does someone have a good pair of lungs? Where do you need the mic? Or?
I have a question regarding Daenerys and her role as, like, you know, in military and war. Like any sort of woman that was involved in warfare?
Yeah.
Or
women actually had roles in leadership of warfare quite frequently, mostly to defend cities, and sometimes lead armies into position, never on the battlefield. Joan of Arc is really the first one to don armor, and not the first one to don armor, but she's the first one to go in and lead battle. And you know, she's a very, as I said, a very different case. But
Matilda of Tuscany in the 11th century was very dynamic in her leading of armies generally away from the imperial armies that she was going up against. She's pretty much how almost anybody looks at a military, a female military leader. It will be Matilda of Tuscany, or it will be one of these other Scilavecca or Gaeta. Had a role in that way for a while. Eleanor of Aquitaine was with her son when he was rebelling against Henry II. So she's on the battlefield a few times, but not exerting any military authority. Of course, this all goes back to the Amazons and this belief that there were warrior women who could band together. But the very odd thing, of course, you never see the Amazons actually led. The Amazons don't lead any men, and no man leads the Amazons. And so that seems to have been, even if they wanted to bring up the Amazons in the medieval context, done all the time in literature. It was never to allow a woman to lead. And Joan of Arc does not get titular authority over the army. She pretty well is there, and then the soldiers follow her.
Okay, so we're going to take a... our lunch break here, and we're going to resume at I think actually 1 o'clock. We're supposed to be back. We need to stay on schedule. We have two speakers and discussion following, and I can already see how some of these things are going to lead to, I think, interesting interconnections and so forth. But we will need to start on time, so please be back at 1 o'clock. We also have to stay on time because we've published a schedule where people are maybe coming with the expectation of arriving for the 1 o'clock presentation. So thank you very much, and we hope to see you back at 1 o'clock.
Is that right? Yeah.
Of the realm, English as the common tongue that is spoken the world over, but time is running out. Instead, I want to use my last minutes to bolster my argument a little by pointing out that a Google search for Game of Thrones meme yielded 780,000 hits, and that was about 2 weeks ago. The top results included Game of Thrones characters compared to US political figures, British politics reimagined as Game of Thrones, and Mexican parties use Game of Thrones memes. Clearly, Game of Thrones has become a metaphor for politicians striving for power because they are only seeking their own advantage and who are not concerned with collateral damage. The game metaphor itself strikes me as highly topical. In the age of television and internet, politics have become a spectacle. We watch debates like sports events, scoring the participants for hits and zingers. Actors frequently rise to political office while the issues of the day become fodder for comedians. Game is no longer a designator for a shared fun activity. From Harry Potter to the Hunger Games, we see innocents forced to play in games in which you either win or you die. That we feel like we're watching ourselves expresses itself further in the discussion of Game of Thrones events and our newscasts. One example is how the depiction of sexual violence in Game of Thrones has found its way into the national discourse on rape. Is it historically, psychologically, politically correct to show a scene in which a sexual act begins with force and ends with the female's acquiescence and enjoyment? One thing is for sure, that ever since the production code was instituted in Hollywood, historical settings were chosen for movies because they allowed showing immoral or abhorrent behavior, the argument being that historical times were more violent, so the depiction of violence on the screen is necessary as it is historically correct. However, George R. R. Martin came out in this debate saying that, quote, the true horrors of human history derive not from orcs and dark lords, but from ourselves. In other words, his fantasy world that is so devoid of love, of loyalty, of compassion, of transcendence in any way, is the essence, the ugly truth of our humanity. Ultimately, I think Game of Thrones is so widely watched and debated because it is not clear what the truth is or where the story is going. George R. R. Martin is an unreliable narrator who kills off characters at will, who confuses us, who makes us love those who have done hateful things. Most other stories that build their own mythology, that purport to depict the essence of our strife to be human, anchor the story with some characters that know the beginning and the end, that reliably speak the truth and slowly reveal to the hero and the audience what their nature, their origins, their purpose is. But is there a Gandalf, a Dumbledore, a Yoda in Game of Thrones? So far, I think we can't be sure. Does the real suspense in Game of Thrones then derive from the fact that we don't know if Game of Thrones is really a world without hope, in which nobody is the true king, in which those who desire power for the sake of others are too weak to reach and maintain it, while those who are strong enough to gain it are inevitably callous bastards? Or are we just taking an incredibly circuitous route to the inevitable happy ending? Is Jon Snow, a man whose name is both every man's and that of Jesus' favorite disciple, which denotes whiteness and purity, a beltway outsider, the man who famously knows nothing, is he coming back from death to save us? Is he really just another Aragorn, Harry Potter, Luke Skywalker, a young man who doesn't know who his parents are and who therefore doesn't know that he is the rightful heir? Who, like the hero in the fairy tales, grows up neglected and shunned but has a noble character, which, as he eventually revealed, is inherited from his noble parents because, as it turns out, he is the very savior of humanity itself, preventing the extinction of mankind by the Death Star, he who must not be named, Sauron and the Orcs, and now the White Walkers? Is Martin using the old trick of the ambiguous prophecy, like Malcolm in Macbeth, who was not born of woman because he was born by C-section, or Eowyn in Lord of the Rings, defying the Witch King, who tells her that no man must come between a Nazgul and his prey, by revealing that she is a woman? Is his death enough to free him from his vow to the Night's Watch and begin the fight for his throne? I hear he has been seen filming again. So maybe there is hope for all of us as we once again enter the next election cycle, pinning our hopes on Bernie or Donald or Jeb Snow. Thank you.
We have 15 minutes for discussion. Should we all come up?
Yeah.
Yeah. All the speakers come up again. Any reactions to that depressing talk?
Is this cycle in American politics, I mean, in the cycle of, I guess, of our current political situation universally, is this repeated historically? So we're not...
We think this is such a horrible time in our history, but this is a repeat, is it not? Are we not going through this constant battle between those who are more progressive and those who are more conservative? Is this an ongoing battle throughout time?
But I think it's the effect maybe of a political culture where our participation is limited to choosing a ruler every couple of years. So a lot of hopes are pinned on that person then to carry forward the issues and resolve them. But ultimately, I think we're not really participants in the political process, and that's where that hope for a savior, for the good person, for the right person with the right motives comes from. That again, we fall for that. We look at another candidate and say, maybe this one, you know. That and I think, as I said, the fact that that John is an outsider. I haven't said anything of substance yet. So the fact that he's an outsider, you know, that I think that, for example, is something that in my mind sort of a reflection of modern political sensibilities.
So Donald Trump is John Snow.
Well, I think there is a hope that he's not sullied, you know, by, like, the fact to become a career politician would require him to make so many compromises across the aisle and so on, that he could never be like a, you know, by the time you're ready to take the presidency, you're sullied, you know,
I think that's, you know, there's the old joke that George Martin said that if anybody complained about various things, he would kill another Stark off. He's running out of killing Starks now, and maybe starting on somebody else. It is interesting that I think that's one of the reasons why Westeros, Ice and Fire works, is that it presents you with these choices. You choose one, and then he's died. Mm-hmm. Now you got to choose another one. He's died. It's kind of like a political campaign where you've got a whole bunch of people in debates. One, you know, I hope nobody was rooting for Rick Perry in here. Judging from his numbers, not. But, you know, coming back and you, at least they don't die in this time.
Is there someone that any interns?
Is there any? I'll take it. Are there any questions?
Other comments?
Yes.
Right behind you, Stroh.
Just a quick comment. I mean, your political life can be just as brief as a medieval life in, or fictional life as well. And just the lifespan, expected lifespan within a fantasy realm versus the real realm and your choices that you make within it. And if you're just like, oh, fuck it, this is my fate, or I'm going to get as much out of the physical world as I can, prestige, power, destiny, I'm babbling. So just the time frame within you have to work with, whether it be marriage or raising an army or the time you have and what you do with it. And what's wonderful in Martin's is you, as you're killing people off, you create the anticipation of what's going to happen, but in real life it's more, but okay, I'm done babbling. I'm sorry.
Well, I mean, I think it's an interesting point that you're raising, that the characters seem very modern in that they have a lot of agency and they have a choice about how they will act, and there is a strange sort of unmedieval absence of a moral or religious code. There, I don't think there's any depiction of true religion or spirituality really in Game of Thrones, or I haven't seen it yet. So there are some people who talk about values such as honor, or, you know, and Ned Stark talks about this is the law and that's why I have to do this, or I owe allegiance. But then those are the people who die first. You know, there's almost a suggestion that they are stupid. You know, when you see Jaime putting down Jon Snow for his decision to serve at the Wall, which he doesn't see as necessary or valiant thing to do at all, because it doesn't serve your own interests. And what I think is so compelling for us when we read about it is that maybe we sometimes feel like that also, that there are lots of choices, but all of them are bad. You know, that if you decide to play, you're playing with your life, but if you decide not to play, then you're just choosing the role of a victim, because it's a closed system and there's no out. Like, there's no possibility not to play anywhere in the world of Game of Thrones. And so I think that's sort of what's appealing to people, that whether you want it or not, you're part of that.
I would say there's no medieval equivalence of the world that Martin has put together. I mean, even at Wars of the Roses, which he's famous for having said they were giving him inspiration, I think it gave him inspiration just simply because there were a lot of claimants throughout those years. There was never seven at the beginning. But at the beginning, it's Henry VI, then it's Richard of York. And then when Richard is killed, it then goes to Richard, and then it goes to Edward IV. And then when Edward dies, then it goes to his brother, Richard III. And then we get somebody from the outside who really has no claim on the throne in Henry VII coming through. So there's never that type of everybody and their brother. Well, that's not what I'm driving at, but everybody trying to claim, as somebody said, the world's most uncomfortable throne. I think what is very interesting, you bring up the religious aspect, then Martin purposely left out an umbrella-controlling church like in the Middle Ages. But the papacy, whenever there was a new pope, this was the shenanigans that went on with the papacy. They didn't actually raise armies, but there were deaths, and especially when you get into the elements like the Borgias going up against so Alexander VI, getting the papacy, not Julian II, who would get it later. I'm using their later names. The battles within the then Sistine Chapel, but before the Sistine Chapel with Sixtus IV, the battles with the cardinals and the over who was going to succeed the Pope, that is closer to what Martin puts on in his books as political rivalries, because of course the papacy was a big uncomfortable throne.
We have a question here.
So you touched briefly on women in Westeros as well as in modern day American politics. So if we look at Game of Thrones as a representation of what's happening now in America, what would you say that George R. R. Martin is trying to, what do you interpret as how he's portraying women in this role?
I mean, first, I think that, I mean, we read this as an allegory. I don't think that, I mean, I think George R. R. Martin is writing a story that is hugely commercially successful and that works partially because of the manipulation of the reader and the viewers of the audience, you know. So I think we have to resist sort of looking at what he writes or what he makes up as anything more than a made-up world, you know. So, but having said that, I thought actually that Game of Thrones had a compelling range of female characters that have a lot of agency and that engage in a lot of activities that go way beyond the traditional female things to do. In fact, we rarely see a character engaged in anything that would be marked as female, you know, like looking after children or stitching or cooking or whatever. They are often at the table with men at the small council. They fight in battle. They work as healers, you know. They offer really a modern range of professions for women and for women to identify with, I think. The allegorical thinking, I think, permeates our political thinking as well. And so when you look at any successful presidential candidate, they have always portrayed themselves as a son of like a greater person before him, you know, like the son of Arathorn and the heir of Isildur. And so then, you know, George Bush is the son of George H. Bush and also the heir of one of the founding fathers, sort of a similar thinking. So a female candidate would have trouble in that system to make a claim to the throne, so to speak, the claim to be an heiress to a founding father, when clearly the idea that women even had political rights was added later to the Constitution, a document of which many people believe no changes should ever be made to it. So I think it's more difficult to find a compelling narrative in that ultimately sort of ancient story of power and of father and sons.
We've got time for one last question.
Well, this isn't really a question, but I hope that's okay, because
that's
like,
fine.
You guys also said comments, right?
Sure.
I just thought I'd throw this out there about Game of Thrones. Like any fictional story, it's open to interpretation. And I can't help but feel like it, as much as it's about power and it's really dark and it's about human nature as being something that's like inevitably evil and dark and just terrible, I feel like it's not entirely just about that, because on the one hand, Ned Stark, for example, he was one of the first people to die, and he was like the idiot because he believed in honor and like, you know, compassion and everything. And some of that is good, although his idea of honor was so extreme that it wasn't even like morally sound. He was like, he had a problem with Jaime because Jaime stabbed the Mad King in the back or whatever. And that was dishonorable to stab one's king in the back, even though the Mad King would rather have the entire city burned. So I kind of felt like Ned Stark was so trapped in his own idea of what honor meant that he didn't even think about that. Like, he didn't even care that the Mad King was about to kill everyone in the city. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that was less important to him than this whole idea of honor or whatever that he had. And plus, a lot of the game characters in Game of Thrones are actually good people who have good intentions. They just have to make bad decisions sometimes because not everyone around them has good intentions, and they have to work around those people. But take Khaleesi, for example, Daenerys Targaryen. She has to do some horrible things and make some bad decisions, but in the end she does it because she's trying to do something good, which is free all of the slaves in on her continent or whatever. Jon Snow's a pretty good guy too, and he lives for a pretty long time. Joffrey was the worst person in the entire story, and he died before Jon Snow did. So I feel like it's not quite that black and white. I don't know. What do you guys think about that?
I don't think there are any good characters in it.
Any?
No. And I think that's on purpose. You know, if I was writing fiction, and you know, I compare this often to sagas, where you know, the Vikings don't actually have a god of evil because they're all pretty damn evil themselves, so they have a god of mischief. And this is what strikes me here, is that there's really everybody's moral core is based on, do I do less evil, and am I comparatively less evil, and not, am I good?
Also, it seems to me that there are, it's about conflicting moral cores, if there is a moral core, because the opening shots on the credits, you know, are of different continents separated by oceans. Each continent has a different kind of people, racially different, politically different, and however we want to term morality, morally different. So one guy can just think it's okay to sleep with all my daughters and slaughter all my sons, and then sleep with the resulting granddaughters. Other people have different barometers of what's morally functional, and it seems to be a crazy quilt. And if you want to compare it to history, my sense of what Martin is up to is to do a grab bag of pieces from history. So he talks about reference from the War of the Wars of the Roses, but he also talks about French Norse mythology. So it's not one consistent historical allegory. It's a grab bag of what interests him for this very different people, because the Doctari are different from the, who knows what the White Walkers are. Ultimately, we've just begun to see them. So it's a crazy diversity, and about the one thing they have in common is that everybody is subject to the winds of power, and most wind up being destroyed by it.
I mean, if you look at Daenerys, for example, yes, she frees the slaves, but only so that they should voluntarily choose her as their overlord, and that they will serve voluntarily as her armies, throwing their health, their bodies, their lives away for her so that she can win the Iron Throne in a country far, far away from their homelands. You know, what I thought was interesting when I was rewatching it in preparation for this day today, that it seems like power, the idea of power is corrupting everybody. You know, there's a very early on a scene with Sansa, who's 13 years old at the time, and she says, I'm going to marry the prince. And, you know, her mother has obviously an idea that that might not be working out so well. And she's like, but, you know, what if he's not nice and you would have to leave me? You know, do you really want to move away? And she says, but it gives me a chance to be the queen. It's the only thing I ever wanted, you know, is to be in that position. And there, and whatever else is there, her siblings, her parents, she gives all of that up in a heartbeat if she has a shot at being in King's Landing and sitting next to that throne. You know, so there, when you look at Ned Stark, yes, he speaks the language of the law and what is his duty. But if the king that you're serving is busy the whole day hunting whores and fucking boars, or was it the other way around, then what is the value of your service? You know, and if you know that, then why are you there? Why are you sacrificing your family and your role in the North for that?
We're going to have to cut it off here to move on to the next speaker. And when we come back for the discussion after hearing our next speaker, we can return to to these and other issues that hopefully when the draft picks up, we'll be able to interrelate to various thoughts.
So I'm going to give a very brief introduction to Bill Lure, who's our third invited guest speaker. First, I have to acknowledge that he and I have been co-authors on, this is what you call full disclosure, just like Bob was friends with Kelly and worked together on some projects. Bill has been a lifelong, almost lifelong friend of mine, and we've collaborated on a number of books together. So listening to these first two speakers, I know he's going to fit in well since he has a similar breadth of interests and intellectual range. So I'm just going to introduce him as a professor of English and film in the English department at St. Peter's University in New Jersey, and let him tell you very briefly. He doesn't want to spend much time talking about this, but I'm going to ask him to say a few words about his work, and then he'll go directly into his presentation. Bill.
I teach at St. Peter's University in New Jersey. I'm particularly interested in Bob's and Peter's idea for this event because interdisciplinary projects are very, very important to me. The idea of combining different departments, different approaches, is something that has enormous appeal. One of my hats is I'm co-chair of what's the University Seminar in Cinema and Interdisciplinary Interpretation at Columbia. And what we do is bring in visible scholars and speakers or people who are involved in the film and television industry to talk about what they do and how it relates to other fields or what people in the group are doing. I'm also a standing editor of the Oxford University Press online bibliography, which is, I think, the first of its kind. And I review and commission a number of articles about crossing the whole range of my field. And so it gives me a sense to be in touch with people whose interests don't necessarily gel with mine, but from whom I can learn a lot. And that's my sense of today so far, just by dealing with people who are historians, who are scholars of different sorts, so I'm happy to be here. I want to primarily talk about Game of Thrones not as an historical referent or as something that gives a sense of historical backgrounds, because that's been well done. I want to talk about, and not really about a literary project, but I want to talk about it as a television series, as a media construct, and particularly one that's based upon a piece of literature. So that we have the novel, we have the series, and it's easy but very deceptive to think of them both in the same breath. But before that, I just want to respond to one very sharp thing that Claudia referred to, and that was the notion of the legitimate ruler, the legitimate heir, and what confers legitimacy. We're in Arizona. And it has been the center of a number of significant American events that fit into the very traditional notion among historians, where do Americans find their roots? And one from the proof of popular culture, the Americans don't generally want to find their roots in the founding fathers, in a bunch of men in powdered wigs and in formal outfits. Rather, Americans traditionally have looked towards their roots and cherished the notion, my background is from the land. My background is from frontiersmen, from the Wild West. There have been, perhaps three or four films focused on Thomas Jefferson. Same amount probably on George Washington. We're in Arizona. How many films have been based on Wyatt Earp? on the gunfight at the OK Corral, you know, basically a street fight, the kind of which happens in the South Bronx, you know, every second month, and yet it's become a mythic center. And people talk endlessly, you know, were the Earps good, were the Earps thugs, why did this happen? But mainly what they're talking about from, it didn't really become known as a big deal event until the late 20s. What does that say about us? Where do we come from? In other words, do we come from righteous people with guns who were able to stamp out the bad guys and pave the way for civilization? The notion of legitimate heir. In the Victorian era, the poet laureate was Tennyson. He spent the last half of his poetic career writing what he considered his masterwork, The Idylls of the King, which is a very long, fascinating, epic-length poem about Arthur, about King Arthur. Tennyson had no notion at all that Arthur was literal history, and he didn't really care. But what he found in Arthur was an explanation for, and a justification for how we, and I'm talking about Victorians of the mid to late 19th century, how we got here and why we deserve to be legitimatized as the rulers of the world. And at that point, England ruled one quarter of the Earth's landmass and roughly a quarter of its people, and justified everything from slavery to you name it, in the notion of we're chosen. We have legitimacy. Where does that legitimacy come from? Our roots. And that was Tennyson's project, to very carefully sculpt a sense of roots, where we come from, what gives us legitimatization. I'm not claiming that George Double R. Martin is in any way attempting to do that kind of project. But what I want to focus upon is the notion of what do you do when you want to make this kind of, I want to stay away from the novels, this kind of television series. It's preposterously ambitious. And just think about the opening credits under most of the episodes. We see an overhead shot that goes over multiple continents. We get Westeros, we get Essos, but we get the North, and we a huge and diverse world. And in that huge and diverse world, we find the Game of Thrones, the various strugglings for power within those worlds, as well as among those worlds. If you're doing a television series, what sorts of questions come to mind? How do I represent that world? Well, one of the ways is with that credit sequence. And you don't do it realistically. You don't show it as real people on real land, but you do it as a 3D map with different pop-ups. Once you're into the filming, how do you differentiate the world? One of it is simply by different peoples with different color schemes. When we see the world of Essos, we see she's got blonde hair, and aside from Ser Jorah, she's virtually the only blonde in this quasi-African nation, this sort of Egyptian, Saharan place. And her blonde hair is much of what characterizes her. And at times when she's shot from beneath and lit from behind, it gives her a kind of halo. You go up north and you've got a radically different color scheme. The Essos tends to be differentiated simply by mostly yellows and ambers. You go up north and it's whites, grays, snowstorms, steel blues. You drop down to the quasi-Renaissance world of King's Landing, and you get a kind of densely packed, as opposed to a wilderness area, a chiaroscuro visual look. A lot of darks, a lot of lights, a lot of people in very fine clothing, tapestries on the walls. So there's a different visual palette for each land that we see. And the series, when the series cuts from one to another, if you've seen a few episodes, you know, okay, now we're in Essos. Now we're in the land of Dany. So that it's like flipping channels and you come across a Star Trek. you know it's Star Trek just because of the color palette of the Star Trek series. Aside from the differences, we have a very different sense of mythic structure, the kinds of myths that hold a culture together. Because when we're in the major areas of King's Landing, we have a world that presumes itself to be ruled by reason and tradition. People talk about where their bloodline comes from, and when someone mentions something that's associated with magic, they laugh at it. When someone mentions dragons in the first few seasons, that was thousands of years, hundreds of years ago. Dragons don't exist, they haven't existed forever, and the miraculous conclusion of the first season is suddenly we get validation of the fact that dragons exist. So it's a game changer. And the simple fact of ending a season on the palpable presence to us of what's been denied throughout that whole season suddenly reorients us. And that's one of the strategies, because part of Martin's strategy, and certainly part of David Benioff and D.B. Weiss, is to keep the series compelling to its audience, partially by shocking them, partially by fascinating them, and by repeatedly changing partners and doing a new dance. So much of the first season is built around the dominance, largely the sense of justice of Eddard Stark, the sense that he is the person to whom everybody will turn, and with any luck, he's the person who will cohere the world. And then, boom, at the end of the ninth episode, that little twerp has him beheaded. So we have him not only unjustly, by the codes of what we've seen, unjustly executed, but also humiliated and degraded before he's executed. So that we have him forced to make confessions that he knows aren't true in hopes that they will spare his children. So this person who's been built up, just like Jon Snow's been built up for the past few seasons, and now suddenly at the end of the fifth season, suddenly, bam, he's gone. And I'm sorry if these are spoiler alerts for some of you, because part of what's going on is to invest the spectator in certain characters who have a heroic cast in traditional terms. And almost no sooner do we get invested in them than they're abruptly withdrawn, which takes guts, because from the point of view of someone constructing a series, you want to locate compelling characters that the audience likes and keep them, and keep the audience coming back to see them. That's not Martin's agenda. Martin's constantly changing the deck as a way of keeping this series compelling and focusing it not on personalities, but rather on the game of power. And these multiple dynamics that are much too complex for me to figure out. I have no idea what the agenda of the White Walkers is. The first time we've seen them was at the end of season two. We suddenly, out of nowhere, see them stampeding across the plain. Jon Snow's hiding. The leader of them looks at him, and we think we're led to believe, okay, he's going to die now. And there's a recognition, and the guy just goes on. Why? In other words, what? And in the fifth season, we clearly see them achieve a role of dominance in the North. What's going to happen to them? Are they already dead? In other words, what are they all about? They should be impossible because they look dead. Some of them have arms off, half faces. We just don't know. But we know it's another competing mode of behavior for power. Is it going to be global? Is it going to be continental? Is it going to be regional? We don't know. With reference to this, think in terms of the arcs of the seasons. You don't have arcs with a novel. You have the end of one novel and then you have another. But if you're doing a television show, if you know that you need to construct a 10-episode arc, and then it's going to perhaps be 6-9 months or more before the next one begins, what do you do creatively? How do you keep your audience interesting? One of the ways is to kill off a main character, to shock your audience. Another one is to introduce something that was impossible. So at the 9th episode of the first season, we suddenly have Eddard Stark abruptly killed. In the 10th episode, we have Daenerys walk into the flames of her husband's funeral pyre and then walk out with 3 dragons, so that we know that they are going to be important. Everybody's talked about them as if they could never possibly exist. Here they are. In each successive season, at the end of the first season, they're the size perhaps of chickens. By the 5th season, they're like flying giraffes. You know, they're these huge fire-breathing beasts that are largely, partially out of control. That's one way of suturing the audience from one season to another. This is what's going to happen to the dragons next time. We have things within different seasons. So in the second season, we suddenly have people look up and they see a red comet. Well, what's that? But they look up in the north, they look up in Essos, they look up all across the world of this world. Everybody sees this red comet, wonders about it, and then we don't get an explanation and presume that it's to come. And there are a number of little talismans that either cohere individual seasons or episodes or are clearly constructed to cohere the overall series. One thing that this brings up is the issue of authorship, because we've been mentioning George R.R. Martin repeatedly. He certainly wrote the novels, and at one point I said, well, let me read the Song of Ice and Fire, and then I got it, and it can kill a small child. You know, it's over 5,000 pages, and that's just the first 5 novels, and he's in the middle of a couple more. And in fact, he committed himself, and this is something almost, it's not unique, but it's almost unique, and it's fascinating in terms of television history. He committed himself to writing 1 episode for each season. Because of his work on these two novels, he didn't contribute anything to the 5th season. But it's hard to think of. I mean, I can think of a couple, but they're relatively minor, where the author of a literary work becomes a major creative presence in the adaptation, whether it's film or television, because he also has the role of executive producer in the whole series. Now, in television, the executive producer is the most powerful creative person. It's not that way in movies. In movies, it's the director, and it's not that way in traditional radio, and radio was the writer. But George R.R. Martin is not only the executive producer of the whole series, had committed himself to writing 1 full episode for each season, except for the 5th, and also has fairly direct involvement with the other episodes, because he fires off summaries, even of novels not yet finished, to the writers. The other executive producers, Benioff and Weiss, also have written and in some cases directed a number of the episodes. So we have an integration of the literary source with the creation of the film/television work, which is very, very unusual. I mean, films at the moment, I can think of one, if you know the Sin City films. Robert Rodriguez was slated to direct it, and the Directors Guild is very, very, it's quite ferocious in demanding, in almost all cases, only 1 directorial name. And you have to go to war with them if you want to have more than one. Robert Rodriguez went to war with them and got Frank Miller, the author of the graphic novel Sin City, named as co-director. I mean, the Coen brothers have gone to war with them and won, but not many others. And so the notion of authorial power is a significant one. And then there's the notion of authorial power over time. What happens when A few years ago, I did the first season, but now I'm doing the fifth season. How does that change? Raymond Chandler, in the late 1940s, talked about his problems with reading reviews of his work, because he said, not only do I see reviews of my work characterizing me in certain ways, but also now I've got a legion of imitators. And it's very difficult, because when I start a new book, I find myself imitating my imitators. And I brought along, but I don't have time to read it, the show that started last week that you were referring to, The Bastard Executioner. The review from this week's New York Times refers to Game of Thrones half dozen times as palpably a work very involved in trying to catch some of that successful fire. When somebody like Martin or Benioff and Weiss do one or five or 10 episodes, that's one thing. But when suddenly they're doing it according to an HBO deadline, it becomes complicated. Charles Dickens, while he was writing The Old Curiosity Shop, which he published serially, went into a bookstore, and he was browsing around, and he heard someone come in and ask the bookseller, have you gotten the next installment of The Old Curiosity Shop? And Dickens said, my blood ran cold, because I hadn't written it yet. And people were asking for it. And that's another aspect of the success of this series, that Martin and the producers are finding themselves having to not only supply a market, but live up to expectations for the market and the gigantic fan base that's grown up around Game of Thrones. A related area is the idea of who's responsible for bad reviews if they come. If the show is called disgusting, if it's called torture porn, where does that finger go? And can it be said to be representative of its so-called creators, of the culture, of what's, you know, because clearly the review of A Bastard Executioner basically says this is nothing but torture and mutilation and you name it. Basically Kelly's talk. You know, there was a visualization of what Kelly was talking about. So that notion of where does it come from, and how much of it comes from the audience, how much of it is clearly a realization of what is very evidently what that audience wants, because Game of Thrones would not exist if it didn't have an astonishing, you know, a Star Trek-sized audience base. And it's continuing. Originally it was talked about maybe 6 or 7 seasons, now they're talking about 8 seasons, and prequels, not to mention the 4 video games, the probable 2 porno movies, and you name it. In other words, there's a huge variety of spin-offs from Game of Thrones. I guess I'll close on Peter and I have, of the many novelists we like, one of them is Wilkie Collins, who is known for very long novels in popular forms. And someone asked him, what's your formula? And part of Wilkie Collins' formula very much applies to Thrones. He said, it's very simple. Make him cry, make him laugh, make him wait. And I think I'll break there and let the floor.
Followed immediately. Whether this, you know, with
nobody did the epics. Braveheart comes out. People do a lot of epics. They get bad. Then they stop doing it. Gladiator comes out. They start doing it again. They get bad. Nobody's doing epics right now. Westerns, same thing. So how long do you think this? Do you think this phase is going to stay? Do you think we've got a lot of maybe equally good or semi-good until we get a few real bad ones and then suddenly we're on the Romans again?
Let me just read the first paragraph or so of the review of the Basset execution.
Yes.
Do it into the mic.
Yeah, because to an extent it addresses that. A sampling of prominent images from the first 3 hours of the Basset execution. A spear slowly penetrating a throat. A dagger entering the back of a head and exiting, dripping through the mouth. A finger with its nail pulled off. A disemboweled woman, a severed nose, and the severing thereof. A bird feasting on a corpse's innards, sundry slit throats, a soiled chamber pot gray. Too much? Then you can probably rule yourself out as a fan of this grim, lumbering saga of vengeance and exsanguination in 14th century Wales. I could have told you which incidents involved children. If, on the other hand, you watch its creator, Kurt Sutter's ultra-violent biker opera, Sons of Anarchy, you can hardly be surprised that he took a story of repression and rebellion in the Middle Ages and went medieval on it. And so the reviewer doesn't refer to another, he refers nonstop to Game of Thrones later, but his first referent is Sons of Anarchy, which is not an historical drama, and yet he's locating the appeal in violence, bloodshed, and violating taboos.
But the same creator in both cases.
Yeah.
That's the connection, yeah.
But also the connection, at least the creator hopes, is an appeal to the audience. So if I can create Son of Anarchy, I can create this executioner, because this is what they want. So perhaps the Game of Thrones train will continue with more medieval epics. Or it will continue, perhaps, with a 25th century blood and exsanguination.
I mean, I thought it was interesting what you said about the, you know, expanding it by like seven to eight seasons, because there's an arc to the story, like people age and, you know, things happen. If you wait too long to seize the throne that is yours, then you lose your legitimacy as well. You know, there's sort of like a time, an inner timing to the story. If you go way beyond the true king rising to power, if there is one, then inevitably the person will fall again, otherwise there's no suspense. You know, there's like, what can you say about sort of the narrative logic that would have to drive those additional series?
Part of it may very well be in the very short shots that we had of the Red Witch, of Melisandre, of taking somebody who was dying, but pricking their finger and getting blood, and then using that blood for whatever ceremony she was going to use it for, the presumption being that the heir to the throne is the person with the proper bloodline. So that if I'm a magical witch and I have the legitimate blood of a legitimate, you know, heir to the throne, then I can use that into the generation after generation. I mean, that's one crackpot presumption, but they did a good deal about getting the blood, watching it drip into the little container, preserving it, and in the first case, killing off the person who was bleeding, but now she has the blood. I mean, it's a kind of silly tangent on the issue of women in utterly gynophobic cultures. We have these weird eruptions in terms of power. Last week, Queen Elizabeth became the longest sitting reign on the queen on the English throne after Victoria. And Victoria was queen before women were even allowed to vote in England. And before Victoria, there was Elizabeth I, who has come down to us as this robust, powerful queen. So she shouldn't have been queen. She couldn't vote. And yet, boom, she's this historical reality. And then we have Victoria, and now we have Elizabeth. So it's part of it is the illogic. But
it's Hillary next.
What's Hillary's daughter's name? I mean, it's
Chelsea. Does anyone else from the audience have any questions or observations they want to make? We need to get you a mic. Are you going to move it and carry the mic? Move the mic around. Yeah, go ahead and take one of these mics. We can pass this one around.
Thank you. My question is for all of the speakers. What could you say about the fandom of Game of Thrones, thronies? Some scholars say that many fandoms are positive in nature, but what would you say in particular about thronies as a fandom? Do you think they're regressive, or do you think they're sort of a positive viewing community?
I think part of that is going to be the outcome. We've got Star Wars coming back out fairly soon, new Star Trek coming soon. Are the thronies going to remain there? Are they going to go off to... I mean, let's face it, if you're looking for cool uniforms, Game of Thrones doesn't have them. Now, maybe if you're a big, huge guy like me or George Martin, you know, trying to dress up as the Mountain might work, but otherwise, there's no Jedi outfits and cool Star Trek costumes. So, it does depend on its longevity. I know that strange. You were reading the review and when Sons of Anarchy came out, there was a lot of people who you got some of the moral right who wrote reviews saying, well, this is going to be terrible because you're making a biker gang heroes. Bad guys are going to be bad on society because people want to imitate them. Well, the only thing I saw as far as Sons of Anarchy was a whole bunch of middle-aged guys buying Harleys for a while and then selling them afterwards at an nephew. Buys and sells motorcycles, and that was the period. Sons of Anarchy, they found out they couldn't actually handle a Harley, so, sell it back. And nobody tried to participate. No gangs were founded based on it. No violence was perpetuated based on it. And it may have been because Carl Sutter was always able to find somebody who was morally worse than the worst biker gang out there. And so maybe with Game of Thrones, that will be the thing, is that maybe a whole bunch of people are going to dress like Tyrion, and then they won't be, hopefully not off their father in a bog with this crossbow bolt, but who knows.
I suspect that they're going to be increasingly important, because the phenomenon of fandom seems to be unavoidable these days. And the giving of a sense of participation to the fans, so that if you get the DVDs of Game of Thrones, they're followed by these chatty senses for the fans of how the episode was made. I live in New York, and when I see weathercasts, the weatherman says, well, it's going to be 68 tomorrow, and now he'll put up two or three pictures. And this is Ed from White Plains, and he says, the weather is windy up there. So in other words, this constant sense of showing who the fans of the weather are. The machine behind the Star Wars enterprise is astonishing, because I haven't found the level of obsession with Star Wars people, my students, let's say, as there are of Star Trek people, who in many ways try to immerse themselves, almost live the mythology of Star Trek. And many of the Thrones people, the fan base is astonishing. It's, I guess, people literally presume, but I can't speak for them in any real way, and I don't want to make fun of them, but it's something that the HBO is coming increasingly to depend on. A few months ago, Jeff Bukas, the CEO of Time Warner, said, even though Game of Thrones is probably the most pirated show in history, he doesn't really care. He's not going to do a lot to stop the pirating, because he thinks that the pirating is going to help with the fan base. And when you have a producer whose bottom line, presumptively, depends upon what this show brings in, saying that giving something to the fan base is more important than catching the people who are pirating my show, I suspect that says an enormous amount about the weight and strength of the fan base in the economic cycle.
I think that the fandom is not one block of people. You know, there are very many different expressions of that, from the playful and escapistic, you know, sort of making costumes and doing cosplay, to the creative, you know, continuing to write the story, write new stories around characters that have maybe been abandoned. It's not particular to Game of Thrones. Like, we saw the same thing with Harry Potter. A lot of fan fiction and fandom around that as well, with Twilight. You know, so there are these sort of longer stories that build their own mythology but capture the imagination. And in my mind, what they have in common is that they like in Harry Potter as well, you know, you had to wait until the next episode was written, until the next installment was produced. So the fandom is kind of a way to keep people engaged and keep them in the story until the next installment comes out that you're selling.
I just would say about authors of these and those of us who teach students who are affected by it, and I have to now make Game of Thrones references in my class, or the students would think that I would be out of it before, you know. I mean, with Braveheart, we had to bring up Braveheart with, what was the crazy Dan Brown Da Vinci Code thingy that was just dreadful.
Yeah,
you know, constantly having to bring up those type of references. The one thing I think is that it gets people to read. It opens new genres of literature for people to read. I have a lot of friends who write historical fiction and or fantasy, which I think you put Game of Thrones in both in this case. And their publishers are now coming to them with better offers. They recognize that. So there's some really good things that are going on with the fans. And I remember being in England before Harry Potter even caught on, and I bought my first books to that 10-year-old son. And the reviewer in the Times said that he was upset that he did not win any awards because his 10-year-old son had taken it into his bedroom and hadn't come out for 18 hours until they finished it. And he says, I couldn't get my 10-year-old son to read them all. I came back from England with a stack of these, and we gave it to my 10-year-old son's friends, and I got mothers calling me saying, my child has never read a book, and he won't come out of his room. This is marvelous. And so the positive sense of what this does to keep both popular media, but to keep people reading and writing and producing for the next generation. All of that, I think, is marvelous.
If I could just add to bounce off what you were saying, Kelly. And I can't connect these dots, really, but I am intrigued by the fact that more and more people, particularly people who are teachers, complain that young people don't read. Or if they do read, they'll read very short things or something that's on their phone or... And that's true to an extent. On the other hand, we have these phenomena of Harry Potter novels, which sold like wildfire and still sell, and the films based upon them, of the Lord of the Rings, mm-hmm. and now of the Game of Thrones. Again, to invest yourself in the novels is to invest in a huge amount of reading. Again, the first five, the Song of Ice and Fire, is well over 5,000 pages long, and there are more coming. And so at the same time, people are talking about the reticence to take on something more than 10 pages. You have these commitments in both reading and in watching of these enormous, beyond epic length narratives.
We're almost out of time here. So I went in, is this a quick observation?
It's related to this current conversation. I just wanted to
make a final comment and then I'm going to try to.
Sure. So my question or comment was, I think between J.R. Martin and his fans, there's this very interesting tension where the fans are kind of saying, we've invested in reading these books. You need to go and finish writing so that we know what the ending is. But he's got himself in this situation now where the television shows have caught up to the book, so he has to hand off some of the artistic futures to television shows so they know what's going to happen.
They have all the outlines. That's what
and
content.
They could take over. But the one issue that I see is that the author doesn't just write for the current fans. He's writing for future generations. So the current fans themselves could in fact be hurting the art that J.A. Martin's producing by forcing him to hurry up, or the television show could be hurting that art. So if someone had been hurrying Tolkien, or if someone had been hurrying J.K. Rowling, then the ending of those books may not have been so rich and deep and satisfying as they are. And so future generations could be looking at this current fan base and saying, why'd you hurry them up?
Well, it may not why you're hurrying them up, it may be for Martin, would you stop touring around with the starlets and get your books done? And I say that completely out of jealousy.
It's also a matter of the producers of the shows, because the producers of the shows or of the films, once they become very successful, now have a fiscal investment not only in them getting done, but in them getting done on schedule, so that they can immediately put them into distribution. And a little anecdote that I always love is about the separation of popular presumptions about producers as basically money-obsessed people and writers as creative sorts. And for years, Sam Goldwyn wanted to get George Bernard Shaw to write a screenplay because he knew of the power of Shaw's name. And he met with Shaw in London. And Shaw came out of the meeting and said, reporters, said, what happened? And he said, nothing, we couldn't come to any deal. Because all he wants to talk about is art, and all I want to talk about is money.
Okay, here's what I want to talk about for the last couple minutes. I'm going to make a quick observation, and then since my colleague and good friend Bob wanted to stop watching after one episode and then got through four seasons, I'm going to ask him to make one comment, at least one comment. So here's my brief comment. And I think Bob and I, we were really pleased to have these wonderful speakers, and it was a great pleasure not to have to speak and to hold back from inserting our thoughts. But as I listened to them, the thing that personally, one of the things that intrigues me the most about the series is a very complex representation of gender issues, some of which began to be touched upon. And when I listened in all of these presentations, I learned things from, but I want to just take that gender issue back to the very beginning in Kelly's presentation. And he of course was focused upon talking about the past and the actuality of weaponry and fighting and wounds and scars during the actual medieval period, which is of course something of great interest for us to learn and know about. And what interests me maybe the most about Game of Thrones is at the opposite end of the spectrum, which is how this form of storytelling enables a kind of creative and imaginative license that is not in any way tied down to the fact. And I've had this talk about what it's not tied down to the facts. And I'm not going to talk about this now except to mention what it is, which is, for me, I'm fascinated by how much of the series structures in very complex ways girls and women moving into positions of that are traditionally associated as masculine, a woman as a knight, a girl as a boy, men who are eunuchs castrated and put in and or put into various female positions, and it's very complex. Outside simple normative representations of masculine and feminine, and quite challenging in how eunuchs and castrados, and the dwarf, of course, is of great interest to me, as is the figure of the giant, the absolute giant. So you've got, it involves masculinity as well as women, challenges the notions of the representation of the body in relationship to men, size and power, the issue of circumcision. Castration, obviously, castration and power and all those things. So to me, that's an incredible area of fascination. So now, Bob, you need to confess one area of, worry about it.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Just one comment, really, on Game of Thrones. I'm a medievalist. My specialty is Beowulf, and Beowulf is from the period of really heroic literature, the epic literature of the Anglo-Saxons, presupposes a charismatic hero. Game of Thrones is entirely anti-heroic. There is no charismatic hero. And it's a reflection of pretty much the utter failure of public policy in our time. Our wars haven't worked. Vietnam was an utter disaster. We launched ISIS by going into Iraq. We live in a time of utter chaos and instability, and I think Game of Thrones is a reflection of that reality that we all face, and there's some kind of comfort in watching other people in that kind of misery. That's my take on Game of Thrones. But my other take on Game of Thrones is that it awakens in people an interest in the past that Arizona Center for Medieval and Renaissance seeks to explore and seeks to promote. Rowling's books, Tolkien's books, Game of Thrones, Dungeons and Dragons, all these things can awaken a more serious and scholarly interest in the past, and that's all for the good. The end. Thank you so much for being here. Keep an eye on the websites of the Center for Film Media and Popular Culture and ACMRS, and please come to future events. Bye-bye.
I knew you would come here. I don't know how, but today, like I was walking through the library, and I was like, I've been to this library before, and I thought, I'll bet Dave's here. I'll bet Dave is going to come here today. Oh my gosh, hi! Hi! I can't believe it. I knew I would run into